everyone, it's Calluna, and you know what time it is. It's Game of Thrones season once again. And we finally have a proper trailer, which naturally only gave us the bare minimum. But seeing as it's the last season, it makes sense that they want to try and not reveal as much as possible. But I'm going to see what we can glean from the trailer in preparation for the series finale. Let's go. We start with Arya, who looks very beat up and is heavily breathing. It then cuts to her running through what looks like the inside of Winterfell, holding a dragonglass knife rather than needle or the dagger she took from Littlefinger. We see shots of Arya in battle later on, so presumably seeing her inside the walls of Winterfell means that the Army of the Dead manages to penetrate the castle's defenses. Arya looks frightened, so either one, she's seen someone she cares about die, like Jon, Sansa, Bran, Gendry, or the Hound. Two, she's trying to fight one of the White Walkers and is underprepared for how tough they are. Or three, someone she cares about died and is now trying to kill her as part of the Army of the Dead. Arya provides some lines that seem to be before she actually encounters the Army of the Dead, with a lot of bravado and confidence juxtaposed with more of her running through Winterfell. She says, "I know death. He's got many faces. I look forward to seeing this one." Arya has not seen the tenacity that the Army of the Dead brings, unlike the majority of the cast by now. She has never quite faced such inhuman creatures, even with the faceless men. One other interesting thing to note here is that Arya very much embodies the look of her father, with similar hairstyles and armor. Nice touches there. We see a shot of Davos at the battlements of Winterfell. This looks to be before the battle. We see archers and soldiers with him, and since we know he has command experience, it's likely he's been put in command of them. In what looks like the crypts of Winterfell, we see Varys along with several other women and children from Winterfell. We've seen the statues of the Stark ancestors with direwolves, the House Sigil, next to them as early as Season 1. As a non-fighter, it makes sense that Varys is down here, though we aren't seeing Sansa, which is interesting as she too isn't a fighter. The crypts were a good hiding place before, for Bran, Rickon, Summer, Shaggy Dog, Hodor, and Osha, when Theon was after them. So it's a natural choice for a place to hide the population. It's out of focus, but it looks like Gilly and her son are also present here. We know that she and baby Sam came to Winterfell with Sam at the end of the previous season, so no real shock here. What we're really wondering is, are the people down here going to be attacked by, you know, more undead? And maybe can the Night King resurrect some of the Stark ancestors? We cut back to Arya, this time her receiving the dragonglass that we saw her running with earlier. It's too dark to tell who she's talking to about it, but based on her attitude, I'd say someone she isn't particularly close to. Next, we see a few ships belonging to Euron Greyjoy. He was charged at the end of the previous season by Cersei to obtain the Golden Company to try and reclaim the lands of Westeros, while the rest of the story are focused on the battle in the north. As we see the army on the ships, it's easy enough to infer these are indeed the Golden Company based on the gold color of their armor. In the books, the Golden Company was founded by Aegor Rivers, the half-brother of Brynden Rivers, the man who became the first Three-Eyed Raven. After the first Blackfyre Rebellion, he fled Westeros to Essos and formed the Golden Company. In the current timeline, the Golden Company supports young Griff's claim to the throne, as he is supposedly the not-actually-dead son of Rhaegar Targaryen, who was smuggled out of King's Landing before the sacking. The show avoided this storyline, though. The Golden Company is known to break contracts and switch sides if the situation benefits them, so I wouldn't be surprised if Euron manages to use them to betray Cersei in some way later on. We then see Beric Dondarrion, Tormund, and Edd in some sort of underground chamber. We last saw Beric and Tormund at Eastwatch by the sea, when the Army of the Dead broke through the wall, so they managed to survive that encounter. Since Edd is with them in this scene, who was last seen at Castle Black, the two of them must have escaped to get to Castle Black to warn Edd and the rest of the Night's Watch that the wall was breached. It's difficult to tell specifically where they are, though. We hear Bran speaking to someone, saying, "Everything you did brought you where you are now. Where you belong. Home." Although this shot we see is him with Sam, I don't believe that his words are for him. They are kind of vague enough to apply to several people. Arya, Daenerys, or Jon could all qualify. Sam talks with Bran about revealing Jon's true parentage. It's thanks to Sam's transcriptions at the Citadel that Bran finds out that Jon isn't a bastard, but the trueborn son of Rhaegar and Lyanna. They are the only two who know the truth. And one of them will have to be the one to break the news to Jon, which will get slightly complicated once they learn that Jon and Dany slept together. Bran's all-seeing powers are probably going to make this awkward. Next is a shot of King's Landing, which doesn't appear to have any sign of winter around it, Odd, since we saw it beginning to snow just outside King's Landing when Jaime left, so presumably this is still early on. Next, we see Cersei, the Mountain, and Qyburn standing at the docks, and judging by the smile on Cersei's face, Euron has arrived with the Golden Company. A small detail here is that Cersei has started to add more gold back into her outfits. Last season was all black and silver, but now we see gold shoulder pads and chains. Gold is one of the Lannister colors, but the combination of gold and black also matches Euron's Greyjoy sails. Cersei didn't intend to marry Euron last season, but with Jaime gone and her allies few, it seems she might have changed her mind. We then see the Unsullied army walking through Winterfell towards the castle, as the citizens watch them go through. This seems very reminiscent of when King Robert and his procession came to Winterfell in the first episode of season 1, as we see a small boy climb higher to get a better view, just like Bran did way back then. We see both Dany and Jon riding horses among the Unsullied, and Drogon and Rhaegal fly overhead. I noticed some small splashes of red added to Dany's white outfit. The scarf and gloves both have the colors of the Targaryen flag. We've been seeing Dany's outfits begin to reflect more of her heritage as she has returned to Westeros, particularly last season. Sansa sees the dragons and looks both amazed and terrified. We know she was particularly against having Jon treat with Dany, which mirrors Catelyn not wanting Ned to go to King's Landing. It will be interesting to see how she handles Daenerys. Later, we see Daenerys in the crypts walking towards Jon. Either Jon is there to look at Ned's statue or Lyanna's, presumably after Sam or Bran reveals his true parentage. Dany looks concerned for him, so maybe she is unaware of the implication their coupling will bring. Jon, once again, is talking about the coming army of the dead. They are coming. Our enemy doesn't tire, doesn't stop, doesn't feel. This is most likely being told to the last remaining characters unaware about the army. The resignation in his voice also means he's probably been told about the breach of the wall. We cut to Winterfell, where we see blacksmiths forging weapons and armor, and Gendry seems to have made a full recovery at Eastwatch. We hadn't seen him since he came back to warn Davos about the group beyond the wall, so it's possible that he traveled with Tormund and Beric to Castle Black and then to Winterfell, or he was on the boat back along with Jon and Dany. He does seem to be putting his blacksmithing skills to use, though. We haven't seen him reunite with Arya, so that would be nice to see. We see another area of Winterfell in preparation for the battle. Jorah is on horseback, and given his battle experience, it would make him a good commander on the field. We see several Dothraki riders behind him in addition to the Unsullied, so since Jorah is familiar with them and can speak their language, perhaps Dany has put him in charge of leading the Dothraki specifically. If you look at the sword he is carrying, it's being featured very prominently in the shot. It looks like this could be Heartsbane, Sam's family sword that is made from Valyrian steel. We know he took it with him, and he's the one who saved Jorah from Greyscale, so this seems like a decent choice to wield one of the few weapons that can take on a White Walker. Among the Unsullied troops, Missandei and Grey Worm are sharing a tender moment. Considering how many times I've figured Grey Worm would kick the bucket by now, it does seem very much like a please don't die, come back to me moment. He's probably gonna die though. We cut to the top of Winterfell again, only this time there is light everywhere, presumably from Dragonfire. It's a little hard to discern who this is, with how fast the footage is. It's not Jaime, cause, well, he's left-handed now. It could be anyone from Jorah to the Hound to Brienne. Who do you guys think it is? I think it might be Brienne, based on a quick image of the sword pommel. It does look like that could be Oathkeeper. It does cut to an image of Jaime and Podrick up on the battlements, with Jaime screaming at someone. It could be him yelling an order, but since they had this right after the mystery person attacking a white, it could mean he was talking to Brienne. This does confirm that Jaime has made it to Winterfell if he is participating in the battle. After this is the shot of the throne room in King's Landing, which is mostly empty and very dark. This could show that most of the nobility have fled, or is just to show how empty the concept of the throne is when humanity itself is fighting for survival. Zooming in, we can see Cersei, the Mountain, Qyburn, a couple of Cersei's personal guard, and what looks like Euron Greyjoy and a representative of the Golden Company. We cut to Cersei in probably her personal quarters. At first we see, Cersei drinking wine, that's not really unusual, but last season she said she was pregnant with Jaime's child. So if she's drinking wine, then either she was lying last season to manipulate Jaime and Tyrion, or she's had a miscarriage. Honestly, I think either one could be plausible. Cersei will do anything to manipulate people to get what she wants, and she doesn't exactly hide her pregnancy when privately talking with Tyrion. On the other hand, though, she may have been going to such lengths, such as talking with Daenerys and Jon Snow, to try and find a way to keep her family safe. Cersei's warped perception of her love for her family has been a constant since the beginning of the show, so I'm quite anxious to see what happens to her. We get some more beautiful shots of the dragons flying over various parts of the north, including what looks like a mountainous river area. We then see Arya with a group of people, looking in awe at something. The dragons. We've seen part of this scene before in an earlier teaser, so Arya's amazement appears to be at Daenerys' arrival to Winterfell. Since the walls of Winterfell look similar to the mountain range seen just one shot before, it kinda tricks us into thinking this is the same place. Jaime now gets some voiceover. I promise to fight for the living. I intend to keep that promise. We are hearing this over Grey Worm putting on his helmet, then followed by a shot of Jon standing at the weirwood tree just like Ned once did. We are seeing a lot of parallels to the beginning of the story, which makes sense as this is the end of the story and stuff is coming full circle. Next is a shot of the Hound, and judging by the lighting, he seems to be on the battlements during the Winterfell battle. So, yay, hopefully he's gonna have some kind of reunion scene with either Arya or Sansa. We know how much he's afraid of fire, and it was his cowardice beyond the wall that got Thoros killed. So, here's to some future character arc. He's made enough friends now that if someone important to him, like Arya, is in danger, maybe he will finally overcome his fear and fight in the fire. Jaime finishes his line in the interior of Winterfell, and he's wearing the outfit he was in when he left King's Landing, so this must be his plea to either Jon or Daenerys to join the fight. He had promised to fight, but it would have been nice if he brought the Lannister army with him as well. We did see him leaving alone, though, so I doubt he's gonna show up with anyone else except maybe Bronn. For more callbacks to Season 1, perhaps Jaime will plead his case to Bran and ask for his forgiveness. His actions did spark off the war between the Starks and the Lannisters, after all. Jaime will show how much he has changed since then. Next is a quick shot of someone holding a bow. We know that Arya can shoot, but she is seen somewhere else with her dagger and dragonglass weapon, so it's most likely someone else. We don't know too many other characters who primarily use a bow, and since Jon says everyone should fight, maybe non-fighting characters like Sansa or Missandei will learn to use bows to fight from a distance. It's a bit of a stretch, but this shot seems too significant to just randomly throw in. Next are quite a few quick shots in succession. Jon running on the battlefield, a group of soldiers running into a building. This might be people retreating into the crypts if Winterfell falls. A shot of horses running, fresh snow is on the ground showing that winter has come, and it looks like maybe Ghost is in the background. Outside the walls of Winterfell, Dany and Jon approach Drogon and Rhaegal on their lunch break. Just like with Drogon, Rhaegal doesn't seem to be distrustful of Jon, and it would be pretty cool if he ends up riding the dragon named for his true father. Most likely he won't ride Rhaegar until his Targaryen heritage is confirmed by Sam or Bran, but perhaps this is going to be some sort of foreshadowing to that eventual bond of trust. We get another shot of Sansa, but unfortunately we don't see much in the surrounding area, she's most likely on the battlements watching as Jon and Dany arrive. We cut to those same battlements during the Battle of Winterfell, and it seems that Arya has had a dragonglass spear originally. This makes sense as an alternate weapon for her, as she had a lot of training with a staff during her time with the Faceless Men. Honestly, it makes a lot more sense than her suddenly being amazing with Needle against Brienne of all people. Plus, since she's so short, it gives her more range. When we saw her running through Winterfell with the dragonglass, it did look oddly shaped. It looks like her spear might have been cut in half during the fight, which could explain her wound. Dany is in some sort of private chamber, and judging by her face, either she's found out she slept with her nephew, or she's pregnant with Jon's baby. It would explain why we aren't seeing Dany present in the battles at all. It could be she's riding Drogon, or maybe she's hidden away safely to ensure her and the baby's safety. Unless it's a stealth mission, Dany is always front and center for battles, so it's weird we haven't seen her anywhere in the battle for Winterfell. Considering how often her not being able to get pregnant was brought up last season, it's gotta happen this season at some point. Next is Tyrion. In case we forgot, Peter Dinklage is in Thrones. This is the only shot we have of him and we have no idea where he is, other than the Battle of Winterfell. Based on how he's looking, he's gotta be looking at something significantly tall, either one of the dragons or a city perhaps. And I hope you enjoyed your Peter Dinklage cameo. One of the dragons is breathing fire at night. This is probably what the large fire starts from that we see throughout the battle at Winterfell. Another quick shot of the Unsullied marching, then we cut to Brienne and Podrick standing amongst the other Westeros army soldiers. We saw that Podrick was up on the battlements with Jaime when everything was on fire, so the mystery swords person could in fact be Brienne. Got a nice close-up of Jorah outside of Winterfell with the army. And to close out the trailer, we see the legs of an undead horse, presumably the Night King's, closing in on Winterfell. Okay, we didn't get too much in terms of spoilers, but the trailer has answered a few things. Tormund and Beric survived the wall attack, Gendry, the Hound, and Jaime all make it to Winterfell, Cersei has either lied about her baby or has a miscarriage, and there's gonna be one hell of a battle at Winterfell. There were a lot of characters who didn't get too much screen time, if any at all, the majority of which are non-combatants. We don't see Melisandre at all, and we know that she is in this season thanks to the Entertainment Weekly cast photo. We don't see too much of Davos or Euron either. I'm curious to see how Melisandre will dramatically enter the stage, considering Davos promised to kill her if she ever returned. Still a lot of stuff left to see, so only a month left until we get into the real nitpicking. So, which characters do you think will survive the Battle of Winterfell? Who will take the Iron Throne? And how do you think the series will end? Post your thoughts and comments below. I'll be doing episode breakdowns as the series comes out, so if you haven't subscribed, please click below. Follow me on Twitter for future speculation videos or live stream updates. And don't forget to like this video to help keep the YouTube algorithm from sending my channel into the army of the dead. Thanks everyone, and I'll see you in Season 8, Episode 1. Hey everyone, I wanted to take this opportunity to give a quick reminder about how Patreon works. It's a website that allows you to pledge a certain amount of money per month to your favorite content creators, allowing us to actually make a career out of this. Depending on how much you pledge, you get a variety of rewards in exchange. Some of my rewards for you include having your name in the credits, joining my Discord chat room, and getting early access to my videos. Or, at the highest tier, you can even choose something for me to review. Every little bit counts, so even if you can only do $1, that really builds up over time and helps me to make this show even better. Thanks for your support, and I'll see you in the next video.